when we talk about sim development, actually, I would like to refer back, you know, to where it begins actually in UTEM. Now, UTEM experience in developing sim actually during MOOC era, massive open online courses, you know. Everybody eager to have MOOCs at that time. And we subscribe to platforms actually. But the real questions actually that came to us in UTEM, so now in this presentation I'll talk more about our experiences. We never had any PJJ program or distance learning program. We never had that one. All our program actually registered as conventional program, whether it's undergraduate or postgraduate. So none of us actually having experience on PJJ, we call it, right? Or distant learning. So when you don't have those experiences, the way how actually academics perceive education is very conventional. Face to face, you have to attend the class, you must meet with the students. Then came what we call it blended learning. And at the time, actually, we are implementing PTS, Pembelajaran Teradun Sokongan. We're not even brave enough to venture into PTG, okay? Pembelajaran Teradun Gantian. Because what we call it is resistant. Yeah. So as an academic, you know, it's okay to be resistant with certain things. And we face those things, this challenge. And we only started PTG actually last year, officially. Unofficially, we started 2 years ago, right? And we moved up to 60% of our program and all. So that's where actually this SIM came in. And when micro-credentials and ODL comes in, this is where actually we learn about it. But we learn actually through our bitter experience from that COVID-19, where actually none of our students came back for the past 2.5 years. Right, so for that 2.5 years when the student no longer in the campus, this is where actually our struggle began. This is where actually everybody start realizing that actually now this is just a small test that we have to endure in the future. And suddenly came in those micro-credentials, suddenly came in ODL when the vice chancellor at that time said, you better start today. So during COVID, actually this is where everybody learned how actually to deliver your content online. But at that time, actually, the struggle is everybody have their own perceptions of how to deliver the content online. And the easiest way to do, actually, the lecturers prefer to be in synchronous mode rather than in asynchronous mode. So they're willing to go to in front of our Microsoft team because we're using Microsoft team. And then the Microsoft team, when you start doing parallel, you know what happened with the Microsoft team? You start losing all your participants one by one because they will be kicked out from the server and some of the students gone. Because you're doing online and you don't have engagement, you don't have proper SIM to support, so actually you will, at the end of your day, you will see when your session ends, there is few students actually still online. And you know actually the student no longer there since the beginning of your class. Right? So this is when SIM is supposedly comes in to support those learning, because you cannot expect the learner today actually will have better retention than us before. During our time, it was in 1970s, 80s, when the lecturers talking, we are listening towards until to the end of the classes. But nowadays today, even in normal physical class, when you are in your class at 8 o'clock especially, 15 minutes, then they will start looking at their mobile phone, they will start chatting with their friend, they will start looking at how many likes on my Facebook, how many likes on my TikTok, and all those kind of things. So we cannot actually, as what Dr. Biha said, you cannot actually force the student to do those kind of things like what we be able to do. Because the technology in their hand actually become what we call it, what? Long life of their. If they forgot their phone, they're willing to go back to the asrama or rumah sewa rather than they stay in the classroom. So by doing that, there must be a certain support that we call it as learning material that can be accessed through self-regulated learning mode, which is the SIM, which is self-instructional material. So this is where actually we begin. So when you talk about SIM, previously SIM can be in the mode of physical item, just like how you do during your younger time. After your SPM, after your MCE, I learned Bahasa Inggeris through Adabi, by post. That also they call SIM. but not in an online mode, as Dr. Bihar said. But we learn through. And if you look at those Anabi, whoever have those experience, the instructional design of those modules are very perfect at that time. Very beautiful, and you don't need any instructor or any facilitators to help you to go through the learning process. And that is actually the idea where this online sim came in, right, to go. So there is no right or wrong way in developing self-instructional materials, actually. It depends on the higher education provider's culture of, and also depending on the programs that you offer, and also depending on your courses or your micro-credential. But today, I'm going to share you how actually UTEM do it. Now, we are not among the first to actually offer ODL. We are among the later, yang paling lewat, right? And we only have one ODL program that just being endorsed by MQA and GPT, which we're going to run this October. We only have two programs this year to run. One is MBA. But unfortunately, the MBA stuck somewhere in the middle because of, I think it's floating in the ocean. Just like that, what I can say. All right? So, but we know that these two programs actually is a very strategic program. Right? People love to take MBA just to elevate their credential. But people also nowadays like to have data science and analytic program, right? Especially the managers and also the factory managers and so on. So this is about Excel. This is not what I want you to show, but when you're talking about experience and experiential learning, they are two different things, right? Experience refer to knowledge or skill required through personal interaction. But experiential learning is how you embed actually those experience knowledge, whether it's from the environment, whether it's from the industry, to be embedded into your curriculum. Now, UTEM, we are actually applying what we call it WBL, work-based learning. We have a program that actually tied into the industry. And our latest program actually is ZTE program. We have 200 Chinese students from mainland China who are studying in UTEM to take the ZTE degree. We are just the facility provider, but the degree actually run by the ZTE. But facility must come from us, and they are required what we call it work-based learning. Now, when you are running work-based learning through your program, you have to remember that engineering program especially, you cannot go beyond 140 SLT on your courses. You go beyond than that, then EAC will question you, lah, kenapa student learning time is actually beyond than 140 that stated. So now, the way how actually we run work-based learning is, during the daytime, from 8 to 5, students are in the industry, and they are learning through the work experience. They're working, actually. So how actually UTEM lecturer do? At night, they conduct a class. This is the big mistake that actually we learn from those experience when EAC start questioning us, your SLT actually is more than 140 already. So that's where actually they start coming back to us saying that, can you help me do the same? Where actually we will be able to help the student to self-directed learn. When they are self-directed learn, it means that during their lunch break, they can open the LMS and they can study. So they don't have to wait at 6 o'clock and 10 o'clock at night to do those kind of things. So we're reducing the maximum numbers of SLT required or allowed. So now let me tell you the story of our journey in UTEM, why it takes so long for us to develop the SIM, right? At the beginning is brainstorming on the 24 March 2020 during PKP, we're doing online. So at that time, we talking about, do we start with the SIM or do we start with the platform? That's what we do. So if I start with the SIM guideline, we started with the framework, we started with the instructional design, then I might having a problem to deliver those into my platform. Right? Because at the time we are juggling between using the existing platform or actually we are using a new platform. Right? Now our existing platform, or we call it ULearn, is actually only used for internal purposes. And there's a lot of technical aspects that need to be considered by the learner when they are logging in. Because it's very complex LMS. So now, then we start talking about online, we're talking about the cognitive overload. And because of that, we start analyzing and we decided that actually the SIM must be developed based on the platform that we develop. Not, the platform should not be developed based on the SIM. Kita buat terbalik. Right? The SIM must be developed based on how the capability of the platform. So we do the roadshow because we want to introduce this roadshow to everybody about the SIM, about what you need to do and everything. As usual, you know, we receive a lot of questions about it. Until point number 10, we need to be endorsed. So later on, I will show you in live how we do. Now, but be careful when you start developing SIM. This is probably things that we never considered when you develop SIM. Human being, you have cognitive overload, right? This, I believe here, you must of you must be from psychology departments and all those. Human beings have these three cognitive overload that you need to be careful with. Yes, everybody eager about technological pedagogy, embedding a lot of interactivity, embedding a lot of engagement, embedding gamification element into your SIM, but until you've forgotten that actually not necessarily when you have a lot of gamification or interactive engagement, it will create a learning experience. Not necessarily. Sometimes it gives cognitive overload to your learner. Now remember, there are different type of learners that you have to look at. The pedagogical learner, which is kids below 18 or below 12, they call it PEDA. And then you have Andra, which is actually the adult learner. So if your program actually meant for the adult learner, you should not actually put too many cognitive overload. As Dr. Bihar said, her mother is 78 and she wants to continue her master's, for example. How actually technological cognitive overload for this age group of people, of learner? They are different from the young one. The young one are very explorative. But the older one, what they want actually just that knowledge transfer that they want to acquire. They don't bother about other things. So be careful. There must be a balance when you're building this self-instructional material. Balance between putting so many cognitive overload or putting more outcomes into that learning process. Okay? So later on, I will show you the example of how. Now, everybody asks me why Dr. Zulisman still loves this model, this very old model, TPACK. Because some people say, you want to develop SIM, you don't need to learn this, you just need to learn digital fluency. No. If you look at this model, there are three significant that actually is already in your cell. One is actually pedagogical knowledge or andragogical knowledge. Being as an academic, you have this already. Right? So, you must have those. You are masters in those. And then, you masters also on your content knowledge. You are the subject matter expert knowledge. You have. Previously, you might deliver this knowledge through conventional way. Lectures, right? And so on. Now, the third one is technological knowledge. Now, we have also to analyze how good I am in using technologies. Not all the technologies, but technology that are related to your teaching and learning. Now, beside of that, you must use this model also to evaluate your learner, how their technological knowledge capability is. If they are 78 years old, they are different from 16 years old in terms of their perception of technological knowledge capability. Even sometimes we ask our kids to help us to mingle around with our phone to check the setting. So because of that, these TPACK models are very relevant until today to look at how actually you want to build this SIM later on. Because why? The intersection between technological knowledge and pedagogical knowledge is actually become technological pedagogical knowledge that you need to learn. In my SIM guidebook, I define this in detail so you can read later on because we will share with you. And you can read those guidebook. It's 166 pages of guidebook which you can follow step by step to develop your SIM. But you don't need to read every pages, right? You just skip if you don't like. Now, this is part of the content that actually Dr. Bihar mentioned just now when you're talking about constructivism. This is where actually the you tend concentrating on this constructivism when developing our SIM. Putting ideas, putting straightforward knowledge, clear guide knowledge to go in, right? Because we don't want to give all those jargons that actually they don't need during their learning process. Now, even I try to coin a new thing like Dr. Bihar. You look at the bagi student learning time. Now we should call learner learning time because you don't call them student anymore. We should not call them student anymore. Andra students should not call student, they should call as learner. When we acquire knowledge, it means we're learning. We no longer become student. We should call them as learner. That's why I coined all those words nowadays, learner, learner, learner. I don't coin the word of teaching and learning. I call the word learning and teaching. I want the student to learn first. That's where actually SIM comes in. Let them learn and then you teach. You don't teach and then they learn. We should switch those terms also nowadays in your classroom. Now, I always also go to this part, which is learning style. I like to use this one. Some people don't like to use it. But remember that 60% of your learners, and even 60% of the people here that are attending this, actually 60% of you actually are visual learners. You learn through visual. But how to make your visual immersive and interactive, that is the second question that you need to start looking at when you're putting into your SIM. Now, the rest of the balance of the learner in this room and also outside there, they might be an oral learner, audio learner. Student who close their eyes, but their ears open wide, just like an elephant. Okay. The second one is the student who like to scribble, just like I see our director of UM Center ni tadi, Dr. Ni Hadi. He's scribbling. He's actually reading and writing learner. He like to scribble, right? Not many of us nowadays. Eh? Very rare if you can find somebody like to scribble and write. Very rare nowadays. That's why if you check every single of you here, when you start tulis nota, mesti tulisannya macam dulu dia panggil tulisan doktor. Because we never practice writing anymore, isn't it? And after that, in UTEM, because of our program is practice and application oriented, then a lot of program, majority of the program must have kinesthetic component inside, learning by doing. Learn the software, learn the equipment, simulate data and all. It's a kinesthetic. Code the line of program and so on. So our program are different. Our program is 3 credit hours equal to 4 contact hours. It's not 3 credit hours equal to 3 contact hours. It means that the lecture is 2 hours and the lab is 2 hours. And it's actually totally 2 different teaching plan. So one lecturer in UTEM must cater for 2 type of teaching plan, 2 type of teaching material preparation, and 2 type of teaching delivery. And your LMS must cater for those 2. That is the challenge being as technical universities, to build the online content and teaching through online. That's why our resistance is about 60%. Because our faculty have 80% of them are engineering. Right? And we always argue with EAC. I don't know, Dr. Bihan, how's our relationship with EAC. But UTEM relationship, especially our e-learning center with EAC, is not good. Now, then it comes to instructional design, which I'm going to talk about in my guidebook. Now, there are so many models that you can use, but in UTEM we don't actually apply sangat pun modeling. But in the guidebook, you have to go through. Okay? We always go to these 3 models only. You give them more model, then we'll start questioning you what is that model is for. Because in UTEM, kita tak ada faculty of education. We are purely by process to be a lecturer. You need to go to kursus asas pengajaran and so on. Even, they have PowerPoint slide, they have handout note, they don't think that one is actually teaching material. So when you talk about SIM, self-instructional material, they thought it must be online like Dr. Bihan said. No. Self-instructional material means that actually, we tambah kalau self-instructional means that any material that you give to the student must be able to self, what? Describe, self-explain what actually you want the student to do. If the student start asking you back, what I need to do means your SIM is not correct, proper. Okay? So now, because of we build our SIM based on our platform, this is the snippet of our platform, right? And later on, I'll show you how actually technical courses like this, which require software, then you can teach them online. Okay? Our content is straightforward. I'll show you the content later on. Our content tak ada jargon-jargon. We don't have any jargon on the left and on the right. the learning process that we build in our sim actually straightforward. We call it linearity user experiences. There is no other place that you go out beside of this part of the LMS. Now, why it happened like this? Remember this thing. When the learner actually learn through online, especially, they might be access their content through different type of devices. Some of them, they just have their phone to go through. Some of them, they have their tablet to go through. Some of them, they will have their laptop to go through. Now, if you provide them with what we call it technical overload, that's another new term, they will stop learning. Motivation of learning is not only provide them with every single engagement. Motivation of learning at the beginning of when they open the LMS is when they see the experience of those content at the first sight. What people say in Malay is jatuh cinta pandang pertama. The first love, the first love from the first sight. And because of that, we built our sim based on this requirement of our LMS to provide the simple way of navigating. Right? Now, beside of that, how actually we control the sim? Because a sim need to be controlled, there's a quality check that we go through. Our LMS also provide review section. When all this learner, when all this instructor actually design and develop and curate and create the content, the sim, when they submit, it doesn't mean it passed the first gate. Once you submit, that red button DF will become gray. DF means all these courses still under development. It doesn't pass anything. Once you submit at the end, it will go to RV. It become RV. Then RV means it goes under revision or review. We have two stages of review, our SIM. One is actually the e-learning center who actually only check the instructional structure, we call it. Whether you put the correct places, whether the SLT is enough or not, whether the video is, when you claim is 10 minutes video equal to 1 hour, whether actually the video is 10 minutes, properly 10 minutes or not. So that will be checked by the first gate. The second gate, actually, we will open this platform. We will invite the subject matter expert. Means that there is another lecturer that teach exactly the same subject, the same courses, and we ask them to review the content. Whether the content actually, minimum what we require is 80% similarity, kesetaraan. Our UTEM kesetaraan ikut MQA adalah 80% untuk beri transfer credit. So we follow those 80%. So your content must be 80% exactly the same as the conventional content if it's aggregated content courses. So that SME will check one by one. Now how actually we galakkan mereka menjadi reviewer? We give them incentive. In UTEM, ini kena cerita sikit lah tadi kena spill out. In UTEM, if you develop one micro-credential, only 8 SLT, 8 hours SLT, not even 40 requirement by any, we will give you 5,000 ringgit. Now, it is not in the form of grant. It's not in the form of grant, because kalau grant, you tak dapat duit kan? If it's grant, you need to be allocated with vote, with 29 vote berapa-berapa tu, end up you don't get anything. Tadi saya ada spill dengan Dr. Hadi, you try, pergi jumpa, saya kata, put it under grant, tetapi di dalamnya dalam bentuk grant PRN. The guideline should be like PRN grant. The only grant under the ministry, mostly, that can be paid into the researcher, which is PRN. Grant PRN. That's how I do it. So, everybody yang buat micro-credential, you will get 5,000 ringgit. Now, how do you get those 5,000 ringgit? When you pass those button to AP. Once the button of AP become green, we will give you the cash money into your bank account. Without any condition. Second one, Everyone who developed SIM for ODL or even micro-credential, the university will give you 50% from the profit. If your micro-credential actually accumulate 1,000 enrollment, eh? For example, 1,000 enrollment. Even if your micro-credential is only 10 ringgit, you will get 5 ringgit per enrollment without any condition. So that's how we give quote-unquote support lah. Moral support. Alright? So that's how it works. Okay, because I don't have a lot of time. Now, I'm sharing you this part yang saya kata reviewer tadi dalam LMS. This is how actually if you become a reviewer, this is your dashboard. You will see there is some courses that actually still under review, still under progress, so everybody can monitor whether you are already completed your development of micro-credentials, right? Now, this is the books that I'm going to share with you, especially the Designing Self-Instructional Materials SIM Guidebook. If you're willing to read, it's free of charge, right? So you can distribute to tadi nanti, urus dia, and if they're willing to learn the deeper part, nanti Dr. Bihar pun dah pernah tengok lah, mungkin dia pernah share kat MEPTA. I think some people mungkin pernah tu, 166 muka surat. 160 pages, nobody going to read, but try. Right? Okay. Now, we give other materials to the lecturers, right, to develop. Now, I'm going to go for the real life SIM, because of this is probably the one that you want to see, how actually we build our SIM. Now, this is our platform. Everybody use Moodle because we don't have budget. We always run from zero budget. We even unsubscribe from Open Learning because we don't have money to pay. So we use these kind of things. Oh, saya ingat masuk. Sebab saya dah masuk. Alright, just a little bit of how we do it. Now, let's say our platform consists of three categories. Micro-credential, learning path, and programs, ODL program. We no longer have MOOC. We try to silence the MOOCs, and we change that to learning path. So what we do actually is, you go from a smaller credit, micro-credential, and if that micro-credential contain smaller unit that you can stack, then it will sit under the learning path. Now, from those learning path, if you accumulate the whole 120 credit, then that will sit on your ODL program. So, because of that, the way how we design our SIM are very different, right? So, let me choose one. Courses of micro-credential. Okay. I go to one of the research. For the learner, it's very simple. You can go. Tak jadi masalah. Let me search courses. Okay. This is courses that actually require technical, practical, and software. Straightforward, if you want to go to micro-credential, in my guidebook, now, these courses actually, this micro-credential course actually taken from the actual curriculum. So it can be stacked, and you earn the credit transfer into the academy. But the only way that I teach all these developer is, the topic here, inside the real curriculum, it doesn't sound like this. We twist it to make it more persuasive. When you're developing a micro-credential from your accredited program, The best way to do is actually to twist those topics, but don't twist the content. Just twist the topic because of why? There might be hundreds of micro-credentials in this world that exactly providing the same thing as you. So you must be able to sell your micro-credentials if you want to earn the profit. So we teach in my guidebook, I teach you how to create topics, how to structure the sentence. Even a simple thing of course description, also in my SIM guidebook, if you want to read. How to create, what do and what don't inside that, right? So be careful with that. So once you go in, I can preview my course because I'm the super admin. A simple, straightforward, micro-credential using H5P a lot. We use a lot of H5P just for simple engagement, just to start to begin with. Yeah? And we embed those, we don't go out from the link. Okay? You use next button to go, or you can use from the link here, and we cover the ARK just now. People like to read, people like to see visual, people want to see other things, people want to see videos and images, so we go in. Now, where you want to learn the practical part, actually that's where actually you start looking at when the instructor said, download the equipment and so on. And we have the video embedded. We don't go out from this. Even your video is in YouTube, you don't go out from these learning elements. It's not good for your video to link out if unnecessary. If you require a link that needs to go out, make sure it must go out properly. And it must go back into your main learning management system properly. That is the instructional practice yang betul dalam you designing your ID of your content. Once you start going out, because it's a web-based, it means you are opening more tab. And you've forgotten which tab actually belong to the other tab. So if not necessary, don't go out from your elements. Now, because why? You have to look at those technological cognitive overload by the 78 years old or 60 years old. They want to study later on. For ourselves, even then, I'm 52. Sometimes I just penat that with all those technological overload, right? Now, this is an example. How many minutes I need to go? Because I have to go. Nanti ada soalan. Time's up, eh? Alright, that's it lah. Mungkin yang sebelum tujuh sim. But you can go through in here. If anybody want to access into this, mana tahu nak jadi sumber inspirasi, you can ask me later. Thank you very much.